All right, next up, we're here in the back of our Jeep. We're gonna pull off this rear tire so we can replace the rotor, the parking brake shoes, and while we're at it, we're gonna pull out the axle shaft and replace the axle shaft bearing and seals for our Dana 44A. We'll go ahead and pull off the tire. All right, up first, to get our rotor off, we're gonna need to remove our caliper and our caliper mounting bracket. Now, one easy way to do this, just go ahead and remove the two caliper mounting bracket bolts and take the whole assembly off in one shot. Of course, be careful not to stretch or damage your brake line. With the two bolts out, you can go ahead and pop off the caliper and bracket assembly, and it'll rest here actually pretty stable. Let's keep a close eye on it, and we're making sure we're not stretching or pinching our brake line. All right, now we've got to get the rotor assembly off. Now, this rotor, compared to the front, you'll see it's kind of got a high hat area here. There's actually the parking brake mechanism inside here. It's a couple of smaller brake shoes. That's one of the big things we're going to be replacing, and we'll show you why. I've had this rotor off recently, so it shouldn't be too bad to get off, and I'm sure it'll still be a little bit of a pain, but these do require a lot of hammering to get them off. The best bet is to come from behind. Be careful of your caliper assembly you've got sitting over here. And of course, turn the wheel to kind of help out. So we're going to use our BFH. Good. We got lucky, only because I had it off not too long ago. All right, so there's our rotor assembly. Okay, here's our axle that we're gonna remove. Here's the brake shoes. Let me actually grab the other camera to give you a close-up view. So this is our axle assembly that we're gonna be removing, and these are our parking brake shoes we're gonna be replacing. You can see that the pad material is starting to chip off on them, so they definitely need to be replaced. This can actually cause some noise in the back because this pad material chips off and actually gets stuck in the rotor hat and behind the heat shield and can make all kinds of racket and squeaking. All right, so now we're going to go ahead and be pulling out our axle shaft, but before we do that, really quick, there's a couple retaining methods that axle shafts use in these housings. One could be the C-clip method, in which there's actually C-clips within the center housing. They require you removing the diff cover and a few other things to push the axle in, remove the C-clip, and then be able to slide them out. Luckily on the WJ, it utilizes a retainer plate with four bolts on the back side, or nuts actually, and once we take those off, we'll be able to slide the axle assembly out without removing our center cover, which is good because we just replaced the fluid in it. The other good thing, the level of fluid in the axle is not above the axle tube, so there shouldn't be any fluid that comes out, maybe a little residual that's in there, but you're not going to be gushing fluid as you pull these out. So definitely nice and easy on the WJ without having to pull that center cover or worry about losing any fluid. If you're just on the fluid, you can still pull these axle shafts out. All right, so first things first, we're going to remove the retainer nuts on the back. There's four of them. Let's get back here and make sure we get a little bit of lubricant on the threads. Okay, and then we can go ahead and get these loose and pull them off. Now you will see your ABS sensor wire back here. If you're careful, I don't see a need to remove it. Alright, there's one. And there's four. Alright, so before we move on, real quick, just a couple tactics for getting the axle out. Alright, so let's go over a few tactics for getting the axle out. So you're going to need to get a little pressure on the axle to get it to pull out. It shouldn't just pop out unless your bearings are completely shot and they separate on you. So there's two methods that you would use to go ahead and get this axle loose. The first one, if you have the tool, you can go ahead and use a slide hammer. And the slide hammer works by getting the right adapter. In this case, this one should fit. Let's see if it does. It's spun on. All right, so with your slide hammer, you could find an adapter that works. You could put it over your lug nut studs, go ahead and put on a couple lug nuts, and then use that to go ahead and, as a slide hammer, that allows you to pull it out. So that's one method you could do. And there's different types of adapters. You have the claws that then come behind. If you've got enough stud length, you can get a good amount of threads on, you could use something like this. In our case, I'm not even gonna worry about this. I'm gonna show you a method to do it, assuming you don't have a special tool, you don't have a slide hammer. Well, you do have your brake rotor, especially since we're replacing it, we're not too worried about it. So let's go ahead and put it on backwards. Okay, we'll take two of our lug nuts and get them on. Do one there, we'll do one here. Bring those on really fast. Okay, and once you got that on, just take your hammer. And there you go, that's one trick for removing that axle that first bit without using a special tool like a slide hammer. Just remove our lug nuts, take our rotor off one more time. All right, now we can go ahead and remove our axle assembly. So we're gonna be careful that we don't scratch anything, so. Okay. There we go, there's our axle shaft. All right, now the only thing you're gonna need to do is if it does not come out with the actual bearing assembly down here, you do have a bearing race to remove, and it should pretty much just pop out like that. Okay, so this would actually, and you'll see on the new one we assemble, would be down here. So with our axle shaft up on the bench, we can get a closer look at the parts we're gonna go ahead and replace. We're gonna go ahead, we bought a kit that comes with a new bearing retainer, the bearing and race, the seal, and this retainer plate. So we're going to need to remove all four of these pieces, and of those, these two are pressed on. Now, as you can see, there's no easy way to get this on our shop press and press these out. So what a lot of folks do, they'll take this down to the machine shop with the new kit, have these pressed off, the new items pressed on, then all you gotta do is come back and reinstall everything, which is quite simple. What we're gonna go ahead and do, we're going to remove these pieces, get the rest of it off, and then we'll go ahead and use our shop press to press on the new parts. Now to get these off, we're gonna pretty much have to cut them off. So what I'm gonna do is use a center punch on the bearing retainer. I'm gonna drill it out, and that'll weaken it, and then using a cold chisel, I'll be able to snap it. And then I'll kind of do the same, but I'll use a Dremel cutoff tool. I'll cut the bearing cage, remove all that, and then the inner race, we'll go ahead and cut, use a cold chisel just to crack it, and then, as you'll see, we'll slide right off the axle tube. First up, we're gonna go ahead and center punch this bearing retainer. With a hole center punch so that our drill bit doesn't slip off, we're going to go ahead and remove some material from our bearing retainer and then use a cold chisel to crack it, have it lose its press, press fit, and slide off. Same with the bearing, we're going to use a Dremel tool to cut away the cage, and then the inner race we'll use a cold chisel on as well. All the while, we have to be extremely careful that we do not nick or damage the surface at all, especially where things press fit on. So it's a very, very careful operation here. Of getting the parts to break and lose the press fit and come off without touching or damaging the axle shaft itself. Alright, now that we've drilled quite a bit, we'll go ahead and try our cold chisel out, and if the piece doesn't crack and we determine we need to remove more material, we'll come in with the drill and do that. I'd rather do it in stages rather than mistakenly drill all the way through and damage the surface underneath. Go. All right, as you can see, from using our cold chisel, it allowed us to crack that bearing retainer and split it apart a bit. So, as you can see, it will now go ahead and slide right off. Okay, and of course, we'll be cleaning everything up from all the metal shavings. All right, so next up, we're going to use a Dremel tool to cut into our bearing and remove the outer cage. And then we'll go ahead and do kind of the same thing we did on that bearing retainer with our inner race. Outer ring. Can we just a little more? And once that's done, we can peel the cage away. Don't worry about everything falling out. We're replacing this bearing anyway. Hopefully you were able to see that. We weren't zoomed in too far, but we went ahead, once we got the cage cut, we were able to peel it away. Don't worry about the rollers falling out. And all that's left is the inner race, which we're gonna cut and chisel next. But before we do that, I found you can actually go ahead now and pop off the seal and retainer and get those out of the way. It makes looking when you're cutting just a little bit easier, so. Pop those off. So here's that bearing plate retainer. Here's our seal. Slide those away. All right, so all we've got left is this inner race. We're gonna cut a couple notches in it, and then we're gonna use our chisel to go ahead and take care of it. Now this one has some very close tolerances. It's not as thick as the bearing retainer, and also it's right near this edge. So when you're using the Dremel tool, you've got to be very, very, very careful that you don't cut through. As you can see, our punch is now stuck in there. We're spread apart just a little bit, so we should be good to go.
go. Get a little more in the back here just to spread this piece. Make sure it's cracked all the way through. Now this one's tight enough, you're probably going to want to have your punch stay in there as you slide it out. At least till you get past the main part. There we go. Slide that out. Hopefully you can see the crack in there. We can try to spread it apart a bit. So now we just clean up our axle shaft. We're ready to head over to the press. Make sure we get all the metal shavings cleaned off. We'll use a little bit of brake cleaner to clean everything up. We'll head over to the press and we'll go ahead and get our new parts on, get them pressed in. All right, so we got our axle standing up, resting on the lug nut studs. We're gonna go ahead and slide on the new parts before we head over to the press. First things first, we mentioned, get everything cleaned up, make sure there's no dirt, metal shavings, lint from the rag, anything like that on these surfaces. We wanna make sure everything's nice and clean. It's also a good time to check your axle for any signs of damage. Luckily, we're in good shape here. All right, so we can go ahead and lay on our components. First will be the new bearing retainer. Make sure you have the studs pointing in the right way. They're going to go this way because they go through the backing plate. Okay. And this just sits loose in here until it's bolted on. Next is our seal. I put a tiny, tiny bit of grease on it just to make sure it doesn't get damaged when we're putting it back in. It slides up over, and that goes up on this lip. Next up is our bearing. It has the outer race already installed, and I like to pack them with a little bit of grease, just to protect them on that first time you roll out on them before oil comes up from the center dip. They do come with a little bit of oil from the factory, but I figure this is just a little bit of extra insurance. Make sure that you put this on the right way. Remember when we took it out, the outer race had come off and we had the taper going this way on the bearing, so make sure when you put it back in, you have it going the right direction. All right, and that won't drop down all the way because it needs to be press fit on. Finally, our bearing retainer. With everything slid on, we can now head over to the press. Once you make sure everything is centered, we're ready to go ahead and use our press. We'll keep a close eye on everything as we go along. Alright, there we have it, our parts are pressed on. You'll know when you're on far enough, you hit that ledge, you'll definitely feel it in the press. We just remove our axle from the press. Good to go. And there we have it, our new parts are pressed on. So before we replace the axle, we're going to go ahead and swap out these parking brake shoes while we can get a good view of everything. Replacing these parking brake shoes is not all that difficult. If you've ever done drum brakes, it's much the same. In fact, I think it's a little easier. First off, this is our mechanism. This is what you would normally see as the wheel cylinder, but in this case, it's a mechanical mechanism that's cable driven. That'll push these pads apart, and then they pivot against this adjuster. As they expand, they contact the inner hat of the rotor and act as the parking brake. All right, so first, we're gonna remove this spring. Then we'll go ahead and be able to remove our adjuster. We'll be able to pop these out,
compress these a little bit, and that should give us enough room. This spring's a little tight. We'll be able to pop that spring out, take the shoes out, get the new ones, and get everything on. So although these are pretty simple, they're still drum brakes. These springs are still very tight, so they can still be quite a pain to do. Now it's a good idea, as you take things off, to go ahead and lay them out so you can see how they go back on. These spring clips, you just push them in, and then the center retainer you turn, and it'll allow it to slide out. It can be a little fused with rust, so don't be afraid to use a little bit of persuasion to get them loose. Okay. Again, keep everything in the direction and orientation that it came off, especially your adjuster. There's our adjuster. I always find that once you do that, you can kind of have the shoes come in like this. You don't have to wrestle off this one spring. There we have it. Now just come in, clean up this main area without getting any dirt in that, in the axle tube. Be careful of this. This is your ABS sensor, so you want to be careful of that. Put a little bit of brake grease on our mechanism here so it doesn't get on the shoes. Any of the parts that rotate. Fortunately, putting everything back together is the reverse of removal. That means it's a pain in the butt, and you can curse in reverse. One thing I want to go ahead and do is back your adjuster in all the way, since we're putting new ones on. Go ahead and grease it up as well. Make sure it moves nice and free. Greasy. First things first, we'll install the new shoes. Get them on those retainers. Make sure the notches of the shoes go into the corresponding notches of your brake mechanism. All right. Before we install the adjuster, we're going to go ahead and get the front spring on because it's quite tight. I found you get just a little bit more room if you hold out on doing that adjuster. Jeez. So I went ahead and pulled off that top retainer so I could pull the shoe out. I'm having a little trouble getting the spring back on, so I'm going to try installing it like this. Put it up over here and then kind of using leverage, pull it up like that. And we'll reinstall that retainer. There we go. There we go, we've got that spring installed because we did that little trick. Able to use some leverage on this end, it was much easier to move. And we'll use that again. Go ahead and install our adjuster. And then finally, I have this spring, which hopefully won't be too much of a pain. Ooh, I like that. First try. Right, make sure everything's seated, that the notches of the shoes are seated in the mechanism. All right, with that done, let's go ahead and just make sure this brake rotor will fit over. Yep, no problems. All right, at this stage, our new brake shoes are on. All we need to do is clean them up with a little bit of brake cleaner, since we had our greasy hands all over them. We'll make sure that our axle tube is perfectly clean. We're ready to reinstall our axle. At this stage, we're going to reinstall our axle. We're going to just slide it into the tube. And then you might have to hold it up a bit to get it, the splines to go into the center section. All right, there we go. Now, important, there's a notch on your retention plate. You're going to want to turn that so that the notch is where the ABS sensor is. And go ahead and slide your axle in. Get your retention plate lined up. And we can use a mallet to drive it. Go ahead and put the nuts on the back of the retention plate. And we'll get those tightened up and torque them down the factory spec. Not good at all.
All right, so we're back up at the bench with our axle assembly, and it's really not where I wanted to be at this juncture, but unfortunately we got some parts that just aren't cooperating. I've already done the other side, had no problems with this bearing plate, so I was very surprised to be installing it on this side, tightening these down just past finger tight before we even get anywhere near where we're going to torque them. Two of the four just start free spinning, and if we look at them, the knurled edge is just totally worn down. They've just been spinning inside these holes. So I, you know, took a look at it, tried to figure out what my options were. I tried to hold them with a pair of pliers. I can't get enough torque to torque them down. I tried grabbing the MIG welder, figured maybe I could just tack the edge and get it in there. I couldn't get a good enough ground, or I couldn't get the torch in there. Just couldn't seem to get a good tack on them to hold. So what I decided to do is go ahead and remove the axle assembly one more time. I've got plenty of grade 8 hardware laying around, brand new stuff. So I've got one that'll fit. It's just the right length. I've got lock washers and nuts. I'm going to go ahead and on two of the four, I'll use these grade 8 hardware, torque them down to the same spec. And that shouldn't be a problem. It ought to perform just fine. I'm sure this grade 8 hardware is stronger than those studs anyway. But it's just a bummer that, you know, I don't know if it's soft metal or what, but these parts, if they weren't assembled correctly, to have those pressed in studs spin like that. Just imagine these are like, you know, lug nut studs are pressed in very much the same way. So imagine you're going to torque down your lug nuts and they just start spinning in the holes. That would be a real pain. So a little bit frustrating, but we've got a fix. We're going to use this grade 8 hardware, and we're going to hope that these two, just like the ones on the other side, are fine, and I can torque them down the spec. If not, I'll be pulling out again and scrounging, hopefully find two more of these.
All right, so I got our axle reinstalled. We've got our grade 8 bolts through. Does not appear to be any clearance issues, which is good. I know those will torque down. Shouldn't have a problem getting a wrench on the one end through the brake shoes.
Once the axle's torqued down, let's make sure our brake shoes are clean. And we can install a new rotor. And after putting the rotor on, make sure we've cleaned all the surfaces we've already cleaned inside the rotor pad. Any oil they put on to keep them from rusting in the box. Then all you gotta do, reinstall your caliper and mounting bracket. Now we just gotta torque the lug nuts and then we can take it for a test drive.